Welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, I'm Jordan. I'm a certified nurse practitioner, I'm a health coach, and I'm a YouTuber. Today's video is another one in my series where we take a holistic, integrative, evidence-based approach to a common diagnosis. We are talking about hypothyroidism. It was one of the most requested on my last video that I did where I asked you guys what diagnoses you wanted to see next. Hypothyroidism, you got it. We're definitely gonna cover weight loss, we're gonna cover diet, we're gonna cover exercise, we're gonna cover supplements and vitamins and certain foods. That sounds like something that you're interested in, definitely stay tuned. Quick primer on what hypothyroidism is. When you have a hypothyroid, I always think hypo, low. Hypo rhymes with low. Lower than normal thyroid hormone going on in your body. And this is important because your thyroid gland, which sits right about here, if you look in the mirror and go like this and you swallow, you can oftentimes see it go up and down. Little butterfly shaped gland right here. A lot of times your healthcare provider will kind of feel your neck and they'll ask you to swallow and they're feeling for your thyroid. In hypothyroidism, that lower thyroid hormone going on in your body is problematic because it's responsible for nearly every metabolic process in the body. Main cause worldwide for hypothyroidism would be an iodine deficiency in the diet because iodine is needed in the process of making thyroid hormone. Here in America and you know other developed countries where they iodize salt, that's pretty much taken care of that issue. So the main cause that we see here in the United States is from an autoimmune process called Hashimoto's thyroiditis, which causes hypothyroidism. It can also be caused due to a surgery, certain medications, caused by radioactive iodine if that's been used, caused by overconsumption of goitrogens, which we will be talking about, could be caused by radiation. What we commonly see in hypothyroidism will be a higher than normal TSH or thyroid stimulating hormone. You would think, oh, it's low. Why would that be high if I have hypothyroidism? That is the hormone coming from your brain trying to stimulate your thyroid. When it's high, that means your brain is pumping out the message like, hey, turn on thyroid, turn on, turn on, and it's not responding. So when we see that TSH high, we know that there's typically low thyroid activity going on. Also see low T4, which is kind of the precursor to your main thyroid hormone T3, or your T4 may be normal in a subclinical hypothyroidism. It develops over time. So we could catch it when your T4 is still normal, but your TSH is already elevated. And to differentiate hypothyroidism from Hashimoto's thyroiditis or the autoimmune condition that I was talking about that's most common here in the States, you would want a lab drawn for your thyroid antibodies or TPO antibodies. And if those are present and those are high, that would indicate that there's an autoimmune issue going on. If you have hypothyroidism, you're probably well aware of these just awful symptoms. You basically feel like crap. It's probably been a slow buildup of feeling like crap for a long time. So here's just a list, you know, of the most common symptoms. It's not exhaustive, but this is a pretty decent list. You don't have to have all of these things. You may have some more than others. As you can see, they're very vague. So it's easy to, you know, write some of these symptoms off and think, oh, it's, you know, just age, or it's just lack of sleep, or it's just, you know, X, Y, or Z, fill in the blank. Be empowered. Know that your symptoms matter. And even if it seems small, it still matters because you are the expert on your own body. If you have hypothyroidism, now what? Now what are you going to do? Medication to replace the thyroid hormone that is lacking coming from your own thyroid gland is the gold standard of treatment. So the common medication is a medication called levothyroxine. I'm not gonna go into the pharmaceutical options other than levothyroxine for hypothyroidism, but I do want everyone with hypothyroidism to know that that is not the only pharmaceutical option. So I'm going to leave a couple links to a couple resources down below in the description that I think are really nice and give a more detail about all the different medications and different formulations of thyroid hormone that are out there. We're gonna dive more into the more natural, non-pharmacological lifestyle things that you can do for these common symptoms and just to improve your life and feel better. And those things are exercise, nutrition. We're gonna talk about toxins to avoid, specific vitamins and minerals that you'd wanna add and really, you know, make sure you're getting a lot of in your diet. And we're gonna talk about mind-body therapies that do have evidence behind them. All know exercise is incredible. It's so important for maintaining a healthy body weight, for elevating our mood, improves cardiac health, and improves bone health. And those top four reasons that I have listed here are important for all women and everyone, but especially for those with hypothyroidism that have that lower hormone. Those, you know, those metabolic processes aren't firing as well as they could be. And so these are things that we really need to take account for so that we don't have even more complications down the road. What type of exercise is best? Well, in my research, I have found that strength or resistance training type of exercise seems to be the best when it comes to maintaining a healthy body weight, to leaning out, losing body fat, and ultimately, you know, weight loss if that is something that is desired. Muscle is a metabolically active tissue in the body. The more muscle you have on your body, I know is kind of scary for someone that is already concerned about weight gain. To gain muscle feels kind of scary because you are probably worried about the scale number going up. But what I want you to remember is that muscle is more dense than fat. Dense in a good way. If you have a towel that's wet, you can ball it up into a small ball, right? If something's wet, you can kind of like make it smaller. If something is dry, it's more fluffy, it's bigger. We want more dense tissue in our body because then we will appear smaller and tighter. And for many people, that's the desired outcome. In addition to that, the more muscle you have, the more it's going to boost your metabolism. Like I said, muscle is a metabolically active tissue. It's going to improve your blood sugar. And the more muscle you have on your body, the more fat you will burn just living, just at rest. So you can actually do less exercise if you have more muscle than you would have to do if you were, you know, not exercising or only doing cardio. I'm gonna leave at least one link down in the description box to a really great free resource, a great video that's just, you know, kind of a first step in resistance training. And you can just start with body weight. You don't have to have weights. Other types of movement to incorporate into your routine would be something that calms the nervous system. So something like yoga, tai chi, qigong, because you're pairing the breath to the movement, going to calm your nervous system and just improve your mood. Other great forms of movement are things like walking, biking, swimming, just low impact, steady state movement or cardio. Moving on to nutrition, and of course, it's the anti-inflammatory diet that I'm going to be recommending to you. This type of eating is really gonna promote a reduction in that autoimmune inflammation that's happening. It's also going to be supportive for heart health, which is very important in hypothyroidism. I will have a link in the description below to a resource for the anti-inflammatory diet, and I have some videos on my channel on what I eat in a day on an anti-inflammatory diet where I do a little bit of a deeper dive there. There's not great research on this, but anecdotally, you know, when I've worked with patients, I have found that many say that when they reduce gluten or totally eliminate gluten and or dairy from their diet, and this is the case in many autoimmune conditions, reducing or eliminating gluten and or dairy products can be very helpful in reducing their inflammation. So, you know, again, the research is lacking, but, you know, it's safe and healthy to try if you would like to eliminate those for a 1 month, you know, completely, kind of reevaluate, see how you feel, add them back in, and then see what happens. That can be really helpful, and you might find that it's helpful for you. You might find it doesn't make a difference, but I do want you to know that there's not specific research saying you must cut out gluten or you must cut out dairy. Those are things that you're willing to try or that interest you. It is an option. Also, just in general, you know, I talk about the anti-inflammatory diet, but I don't mean low calorie. Really, in hypothyroidism, we don't want to reduce calories, which I know can be hard if you're someone that's trying to lose weight. That would seem kind of counterintuitive, like, well, I need to cut my calories in order to finally see the weight loss. Well, the problem is your body's just gonna keep adapting and you're gonna have to keep cutting those calories lower and lower and lower until you're barely eating anything, and no one wants to live like that. A low calorie diet over time can actually increase the conversion of the T4 thyroid hormone to reverse T3, which does really no good in our body. We really need conversion to T3. T3 is like the active hormone that does all the good stuff in our body that makes us have energy, that, you know, promotes weight loss, that promotes heart health, all those things. So we really want to get enough calories to tell our body that it's okay to burn fat from our body. We don't need to hang on to it. So eat enough so that your T4 converts to T3. And protein. I won't go too far into this because I just did a whole video on protein, but if you are going to start building up your strength, do some type of resistance or strength training, protein will help build those muscles and it will help reduce sugar cravings. It will help with blood sugar. It will help with weight loss. I cannot say enough about protein. Let's talk about toxins to avoid. Maybe this is controversial. I don't know. But, you know, goitrogens, they come from raw brassica vegetables or like your cruciferous vegetables. It doesn't mean that kale, Brussels sprouts, you know, all those ones I have listed here, it doesn't mean that those foods are toxic. It just means in large quantities when eaten raw. Like, we're talking like cups and cups of kale smoothies, raw kale smoothies, raw kale juice, like every day for months and months and months. Like, that's the level that we're talking about. That can over time become toxic. So if you are someone that enjoys lots of these raw vegetables daily, like you're juicing with them or you're stuffing your blender full of them in your smoothies every day, it could be beneficial to switch up your greens. You know, try some different greens in your smoothies or in your salads other than the brassica vegetables. You can still enjoy these vegetables, and I'm definitely not saying you should not be eating these vegetables. I think that these are fantastic vegetables and you should be eating them, but you can, you know, lightly steam them, gently cook them, roast them in the oven, and still enjoy them and get all the nutritional benefits even when they're just slightly cooked. That's going to essentially deactivate or decrease that toxic goitrogen effect. I also have listed here some medications, some heavy metals, some other toxins from the environment that you can just take a look at. If you are taking them, again, I'm not saying don't take them. Just chat, you know, with your healthcare provider or the person who prescribed them to you and have that discussion about why you need to be on them and how is that impacting your thyroid health. Fluoride is one of the common toxins. I will leave a link down below to the water filter that I use. It's just like one of those pitchers, but it's a special one that makes sure that fluoride is filtered out because fluoride is found in a lot of our drinking water. And then I always make sure to buy fluoride-free toothpaste. Now we're going to dive into some vitamins and minerals and supplements that you might consider. Iodine is what a lot of people think of when they think about the thyroid. It's very important in making the hormone, like I explained earlier, and iodine deficiency can ultimately, you know, lead to poor thyroid health. Iodine in our diet is kind of like Goldilocks. It's like we don't want too much and we don't want not enough. So before supplementing or, you know, thinking about supplementing, it really needs to be a discussion between you and your healthcare provider to determine what that dosing looks like and how long you should take it, because it's not something that should be taken long term. It's more like a therapeutic, you know, time frame that you take it and then you stop taking it. I'd want to list, you know, some common foods that you could enjoy and enjoy safely. You know, increase some of these foods in your diet and know that you'll get a little iodine boost. Selenium is another one of those common ones that we think of when we think of thyroid health. 55 micrograms per day is what's required for adults. You can go a little bit higher than that if that's what's recommended by your healthcare provider, but that 55 is a safe dosage to think about. And then I listed some foods as well that are higher in selenium if you'd like to go more the food route and just kind of increase those foods in your diet. Zinc is another one that's really important. And 30 to 40 milligrams of zinc is safe to take daily. And you're gonna get a great amount of zinc from things like meats and fish, beans, ginger, and nuts. Those are great things to increase in your diet to get more zinc. Iron is another one. If you're going to supplement with iron, again, similar to iodine, it's really important that you work with your healthcare provider to determine what that dosing looks like. Iron is kind of a finicky thing to take. It, you know, reacts with certain foods. You want to take it at a certain time of day. Some providers like you to take it every other day for better absorption. So again, make sure you're working with them to determine what dosing you need. And, you know, they may test your blood to see that you're low in iron or low in ferritin. That could be something that they look at and determine how they want to help you supplement with that. But, you know, you can get great foods in your diet that also support healthy iron levels. And the animal sources are going to be the most bioavailable of the food sources. So that's going to be things like meat, things like liver, seafood, organ meats. Those are all very high in iron. And then you have your vegetarian sources like beans, spinach, peas, and iron fortified foods like cereals. Some research to show that individuals with higher amounts of free fatty acids, or, you know, omega-3s, in their system tend to report lower rates of those common hypothyroid symptoms. So we could be seeing, you know, improvement in some of these symptoms with more omega-3s. So a great general dose to start out with is 1,000 milligrams or 1 gram per day of a combination EPA and DHA. We're also seeing more vitamin D deficiency in individuals with autoimmune hypothyroidism. So again, another one, have your level checked and determine what dosing would be appropriate for you to take. Daily dosing ranges anywhere from 400 international units to 4,000 international units, and sometimes even higher than that. A big range. So make sure that you're taking the right amount for you if you're looking for a place to start until you get your vitamin D level checked. I think anywhere from 1,000 to 2,000 is safe. Last but not least, probiotics. A lot of times what we see in hypothyroidism are those, you know, GI symptoms due to slow motility, you know, just things moving slowly through the digestive system, constipation, which leads to, you know, stomach pain and bloating and gas and just feeling like you're carrying around an inner tube in your stomach. Probiotics do have some evidence to really help with this. And one that I really like, especially if you're more constipation dominant, which tends to be the common symptom in hypothyroidism, is Garden of Life's Colon Care Probiotic. That would be something nice to try. If you're going to start something, make sure that you check with your healthcare provider before trying it. Last but definitely not least are the mind and body therapies. First one, of course, is stress reduction. And I don't say that lightly, saying like just reduce your stress and you'll be better, because stress isn't what causes hypothyroidism. It's actually quite the opposite. A lot of times having hypothyroidism causes stress. So it's actually the disease and, you know, the symptoms that cause the stress. So anytime we can, you know, just reduce that stress, it's going to be positive and beneficial for how we feel. It's not going to cure us, but it's going to help us lead a better life every day. Some daily practices to try are things like alternate nostril breathing. I'll leave a link to a video below. It's something that I do every day before bedtime, and I find it's just so great. Nice hatha or yin yoga practice. It's much more gentle, calming yoga. Something like meditation, going on walks in nature, or what many people call forest bathing. A nice goal for that would be to get 2 hours a week out in nature. I wanted to mention that there's traditional Chinese medicine. There's some great research that that can be beneficial for hypothyroidism. And of course, we need more studies on that. If there's a practitioner near you, it's something that you have access to, certainly something to check out and research if that would interest you. And here are the sources that I used to create this hypothyroidism presentation. If you liked this video, make sure you give me a thumbs up, give it a like so that I know you want to see more of these types of videos. Leave your requests, leave your comments, leave your questions down below in the comments, and make sure you check out the description box for all the resources that I've mentioned here in this video today. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already and check out my other videos. I hope you have a great rest of your day, a great rest of your week, and I will see you soon for another one. Bye. Care provider. Blah, 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 blah. If you're talk words.